I know you're gonna dig this.
Let's go! Broadcasting live from the center of the universe, it's Business School Without the BS, featuring optometrist-turned-entrepreneur Dr. Robert Zellner with USSBA Entrepreneur of the Year, Clay Clark. Welcome to the Thrivetime Show on Talk Radio 1170.
Yes, it's Z and Clay, broadcasting from the box in the 918. Business School in the topic today. Check the syllabus, it's getting you paid. Making a business boom is what we do. You can do it, let us show you. It's the Thrivetime Show on your radio. It's the Thrivetime Show, and away we go. It's the Thrivetime Show on your radio. And 3, 2, 1, here we go.
All right, Thrive Nation, welcome back to the conversation. It is the Thrive Time Show on your radio. And today, as we do every day, we are focused on helping you to start or grow a successful business. But you can't build a successful business if you can't build a successful mindset first. You know, what is the mindset of a successful person? How is that different from the mindset of everybody else? And I would like to tell you, oh, they're just a little bit different. It's just a little different, but it's not a little bit different. It's very, very, very different. In fact, there are five specific ways that successful people think that is far different from that of the average person. It's not even close. We're not in the same conversation if you don't master these five mindsets. So mindset number one is you have to be diligent. If you want to become a successful person, you've got to be diligent. Now, if you look up the word diligence, diligence means the steady application of effort. That's what diligence means, the steady application of effort. And I think a lot of people struggle with that because that would require working hard even when you don't feel like it. So as an example, Proverbs 10:4 from the controversial book called The Bible says, "Lazy hands make for poverty, but diligent hands bring wealth." Again, lazy hands make for poverty, but diligent hands bring wealth. Now, Eric Chapp, today we're talking about diligence. We're talking about the success mindset. But I would like for you to share from your perspective, what does the word diligence mean to you? And maybe what's the difference between, I guess, brag on a client you've seen who's very diligent, and then maybe walk us through the mindset of somebody who's not diligent and what the differences are.
Well, when you're talking about being diligent, it's that thing like the definition is right there, but it's that thing of having that mindset where you're going to do the same thing because you know that's what you got to do to get paid. You need to do the same thing over and over and over until you're the best in the world at it. And somebody I'd like to brag on would be Dr. J up there in Tennessee, HealthWorks Chiropractic. He has been implementing systems with us for probably 8 months now.
Yes.
He's breaking patient per month visit records. He's breaking revenue records. He's breaking all kinds of records with his business because he has been diligent. And that's what we see with people in our coaching program is if you're not that diligent doer mindset, then you're going to get behind because there's a lot of things that you got to keep going. You got to get going all the time and not stop with. Does that make sense?
I think if you're listening to this show today and you say, well, what does it mean? You guys are talking about diligence. Maybe it's too abstract. I'll give you an example. We record this show every single day, which means that 5 days a week the show is recorded, which means there has to be an outline written 5 days a week, which means we have to post it on the podcast 5 days a week, which means that it means that 5 days a week we're committing to a minimum of 4 hours of our time 5 days a week. Every single week, even if I have a vacation, I have to record the shows in advance or you have to record it on the weekend, but you have to be consistent. Or another example is when I started DJ Connection, I couldn't afford to hire somebody to write my search engine content like we can now. I mean, now with the Thrivetime Business Coach program, for as little as $1,500 a month, you get a web designer, a search engine optimization, graphic design, photography, videography, a business coach. You get all of those things, and you get the web optimization for $1,500. But back in the day, I paid that guy about $2,000 a month. And let me tell you who wasn't doing search engine optimization. He wasn't.
That guy.
Right. And my workday, the workday would start about 9 a.m. And brides typically don't want to meet and take time off of work to meet their potential DJ during the middle of their workday. And so the brides would want to meet when? After work. So the brides would want to have their pre-wedding consultation with their disc jockey between 5 p.m. and 8 p.m. So I'd get up every day, you know, 9 o'clock, I'm working the business from 9 o'clock until 8, but I've still got to write that search engine content. So I would set my alarm for 3 a.m., and I would write content every day from 3 a.m. until 6 a.m. every single day. And that's how DJConnection.com got to be top in Google. And then once we brought in enough revenue, I hired someone else to do that, and then the rest is history. But I think it's super, super important that you understand that the diligence typically means you're doing something over and over and over that you don't want to do before you begin to see the results. Diligence. I mean, the concept of the steady application of effort. If you're reading the Bible and you just Google search Proverbs 10:4, and it says that lazy hands make for poverty, but diligent hands bring wealth. So, Steve, in the mortgage business, can you walk me through what diligence looks like in your business? Because I think everybody listening to the show has a different kind of diligence, a different way that it applies. But if you, at the very basic level, if you cannot be consistent about doing what you need to do, whether you feel like it or not, you're not going to be successful. Steve, break down, what does diligence look like in the mortgage industry?
Well, I think it's in the, you know, in our industry, for whatever reason, I don't know why, but most of your mortgage guys or mortgage companies, Clay, are rolling out of bed about 9. About 8:45 or 9. That's when it kind of like,
right,
they're stretching.
Oh, barely.
They're like, what am I going to do today? And then sometimes, because you have the opportunity to make good income when you're in the mortgage business, people taste a little bit of good income, commission. You know, we work on commission only. And they get satisfied and they get lazy. So then they start working where you used to work from like 9 to 4 or 5. Now you're working like, you know, 10 to 4. So I think to be diligent in our business, if you just got up and came to work every day from 8 to 5, Monday through Friday, you'd be like one of the most diligent mortgage guys out there. And that's what I've done. But a little bit different that I do is, just like you said, there's things that have to get done that aren't going to get done unless I do them. So when I get in between 5 o'clock and 6 o'clock in the morning, that's what I do. I spend, so you think about this, Clay, like if most guys are rubbing the sleep out of their eyes at 9 and I got to the office at 5.
Right.
Then I'm having lunch about the time they're waking up. And so that's what the story of my life is, Clay. That's what I have to do just to keep up. Because I'm not the smartest, fastest running, most intelligent, biggest idea guy out there. I just overwork.
Now, I've seen you run. You look like a gazelle when you run. You have speed, Steve. Don't you know.
I am pretty fast.
Okay,
but,
okay.
Now, Jerry West, the NBA Hall of Fame basketball player, who went on to have massive success as a NBA executive, he said you can't get much done in life if you only work on the days when you feel good.
That's big.
So, Chump, you were a guy who managed a construction crew.
Right.
Talk to me about what that's like, because I'm sure there's a lot of guys on your crew that only wanted to come to work when they felt good.
And not even then, half the time.
Okay.
So, yeah. So, he's exactly right. So, you know, when you're pouring concrete, especially in Oklahoma in the summer, you got to be at work at like midnight, 4 or 5 days a week if we're pouring concrete every day. And if you don't have the diligence to realize and plan your day out and get to bed on time and get prepped for the next day, you're going to be behind every day perpetually, and you just lose money.
I just want to make sure you're getting this. If you are a believing Christian, if you're not, that's fine. But like half the audience, work with me on this, half of the people listening to the show today, Proverbs 10:4 says, again, this is a rule. This is not my rule. It says a slack hand causes poverty, but the hand of the diligent makes rich. This is like a biblical law. If you are a slacker, you deserve to be poor. You've got to work hard. And so what I did is I wanted to be prepared for today's show. And Chep, I went the extra mile on today's show.
Oh my gosh, let's hear it.
So what I did is I thought that people, if they'd be hard to take, you know, it's seriously when you hear my voice reading a Bible verse. I've worked hard on this. So without any further ado, let me go ahead and Chup, just kind of, I'm just explaining to the audience what I'm doing here. You can kind of explain what you're seeing here. Okay,
so here we go.
Here we go.
Right now he is pushing buttons. Here comes a voice. Here.
All right, here we go. Lazy hands make for poverty, but diligent hands bring wealth.
Oh, is that the devil?
Yeah, well, I don't know. I figured that God's kind of a scary voice. So I'll use it during today's show quite a bit.
Fatherly, but, you know, kind of talking down.
I guess the devil wouldn't read the Bible.
Yeah, we'll have to get back. We don't want to talk too much about Lucifer on today's show.
Freak
people out.
Keep it positive.
Yeah, but again, Proverbs 10:4, I mean, think about that. Somebody here is just fighting that idea. You're not even getting to work before your employees. Come on. Just get up. I mean, but I'm just telling you, in our office, most of the teammates, they get there on 9 a.m. because they're supposed to be there at 9. Some people get there before. Devin gets there early. John gets there early. You'll see there are certain guys who are there consistently early. I get it. But I just want you to know that I've always been awake for 4 to 5 hours before I see anybody. I already have a game plan for the day. But I see so many business owners that are just on a fundamental level not starting the day before their team. Your team comes to work and you don't have a plan.
That sets such a bad precedent for your team.
Well, a lot of them come in after.
Oh, there was a guy that I worked with years ago, and he used to come to the meetings always late and never with a plan, and he always had an opinion. And I had to pull him aside and go, listen, dude, like, nobody respects you, man. You've got to have a plan. It'd be like the pastor of the church showing up with wet hair, looking like he just woke up.
Like you just don't care.
The pastor's kind of making up the sermon as he goes. I mean, it's ridiculous. I've worked with fitness trainers. I've worked with people that you can tell, like, a fitness trainer gets there after the people who get there to work out. You can't be a personal trainer and be arriving to work out after the people after your clients do. You just have to. And I think that the concept here, though, Steve, please, there's somebody listening to today's show who's just struggling to be motivated. Like, they want the money, but they're, you know, it's hard because right now they got a headache. You know, their tummy hurts. They're going through a thing. I mean, that's the thing about entrepreneurship, Steve. I mean, you don't get days off. Help somebody out there who's struggling to get motivated.
Help.
Oh, geez. You know, Chup will appreciate this because Chup knows that I like donuts. Chup calls me now Stevie Bag of Donuts.
Bag of Donuts.
It's weird because every time I see him, I have donuts, but I don't eat donuts all the time. But it's just like every time I see Chup, I eat donuts.
It's a special thing.
Imagine entrepreneur out there, if you owned a donut shop. Could you imagine if you rolled in right at the time that your shop opened?
You're not going to have any donuts.
You have no donuts because you have to make them fresh every day.
Bag of No Donuts. That's what they call you.
So I've actually seen this happen. I've seen this with small business owners who have a donut shop who've actually not opened up the shop on a consistent basis.
Yeah, and then people don't come back.
Right.
Because they don't want to show up and be like, there's no donuts, so I'm just going to not go there. I'd rather go to a place that I know has it. But that's a very good example of if a donut shop has to get up early and get there to get prepared for customers to come in, then why wouldn't you, no matter what you do, no matter what you sell, If Quick Trip and Come and Go opened at 5 a.m. every day.
Yeah, at 5 a.m.
They wouldn't be unlocking the door as customers were coming up trying to think, oh, let me get this register on. No, people get prepared for their workday.
Consistency, diligence.
If you're not doing that, then you're... Listen, if you're not doing that, if you can't do that one fundamental thing, then just go work for someone else.
Absolutely.
Let them manage you.
And there's nothing wrong with you. You're just going to fail as an entrepreneur if you cannot be at the fundamental, at the very baseline level, if you cannot be diligent. Now, if you are diligent, the next success mindset you have to grasp, the next step up the staircase into success is you have to be coachable. And we come back, we're going to talk about what it means to be coachable as an entrepreneur. If you haven't subscribed to the podcast, do it at thrivetimeshow.com.
Get ready to enter the Thrivetime Show on Talk Radio 1170. Men, 13 multi-million dollar businesses, 8 kids, 1 business coach radio show. It's the Thrive Time Business Coach Radio Show with Dr. Zellner and Clay Clark.
Oh, Return of the Mac. Remember this song, Return of the Mac?
Love this song.
Man, you know the sad thing about Return of the Mac, though? You know the bad thing about the Mark Morrison story?
What's that? He didn't return.
No, he returned. He returned. The story is about returning from jail. He went to jail, you know. And that's how he came out of jail, and he's, return of the Mac, return of the Mac. And then all of a sudden he messed up again and went back to jail.
And then it was the return of the return.
The thing that he struggled with was being diligent, staying out of trouble. Chup, I just, if we're talking about the mindset for success, and successful people can do the same repetitive task over and over every day. They can be consistent. I'm going to give you an example of a situation about 4 years ago that just irritated the crap out of me, and it almost led to the end of a relationship with a client. But this is a true story. There's a lady I'm working with, and our weekly meeting was always early morning on the phone, early morning phone call. So every week at the same time, if you're a coaching client, by the way, how it looks is every week, let's say that you're a client and we do a call with you every Tuesday. So every Tuesday morning, let's say at 7 a.m., that's your call. So every week at Tuesday morning at 7 a.m., we do the call. That's what we do. We do the same call every week at the same time, and then we help you consistently get to the top of Google, know your advertisement statistics, what's going on, how many leads you're getting, help you convert deals, help you grow the business. But at the fundamental level, we have to meet you every week at the same time because that's what a successful company does. If you work at Walt Disney World Resorts, they have the same meetings at the same time every single day. They open the park at the same time every single day. They have the same checklist every single day. They clean the bathrooms at the same time every freaking day. So we're doing these calls, and she is a rock star. So we're doing the calls every week. We're on time doing the calls. Well, then her husband decides that because they're married, he would like to now get involved in the business because he lost his job. So now he's going to hop in the call. He hops on the call the first week. The call starts like at 7, and this guy like at 7:10 calls in. You know, Hey man, what is that? Let me get my phone. And in the background, you can hear all sorts of noises. Like you can hear him like adjusting the TV. You can hear him like telling the kids, like, "Hey guys, seriously, guys, pipe her down." And you can hear him like making coffee.
He's blow drying his hair.
Yeah, you're hearing like, is this guy maintaining a vehicle in the background? You know, there's all this stuff going on. And then he's like, "Yeah. I'll be honest. I don't really see the point of." These weekly calls, and I know that we're topping Google now, so we need to stop investing in writing articles. It's taking a lot of our time, and we need to stop investing in articles. And we got a trip coming up this week. We're going down for some barbecue. We're going to be going out to Tennessee this weekend, and because we're going to be getting some barbecue in Tennessee, going to go. So anyway, I'm going to see the movies, going to see concerts, going to whatever. We won't be able to make this week's call.
Yeah.
But just send us an email. So then the next week, we send him an email. The next week, he says, "Hey, man, sorry, it's like 7:15 for a 7 a.m. call. Hey, man, sorry I didn't get those action items done. I didn't get a chance to do that. But let's circle back." And each week, he just keeps drifting.
Circle back. Oh,
7:21, 7:28. Now, meanwhile, the lady who's always been consistent, who had done very, very well in the coaching program, who had built a multi-million-dollar business, by the way, over the past year before he decided to hop in with his daily epiphanies, pretty soon he says, "Hey, we don't even need to do these calls. Why don't I just email you? Why don't you just email me? Why don't you?" And I had to get on the phone. I said, "Listen here, buddy, you are not going to be successful. And your sales have plummeted since you've got involved in the business. Your wife has asked you on a fundamental basis to answer the voicemails, return the calls, and set appointments for her. But you don't return the calls. You don't set appointments. You don't hop on the calls consistently. You've got to be consistent. And I don't give a crap who you're married to. You're screwing up the business. You are destroying her business. Like, stop doing it." He's like, "Are you calling me out? I'm the client." I'm like, "Absolutely I'm calling you out. You're a freaking knucklehead. Be on time." So anyway, I'm not kidding. So he ends up no longer participating in the calls, and he calls back a few weeks later and apologizes and this whole thing. But he never, even to this day, I met the guy. He's like, he cannot do anything consistently. And I don't know what the heck's going on in someone's cranium, Chup, if they can't do something daily.
What is it about diligence or consistency that freaks people out? I see it all the time with new clients as they're entering into our system and we start talking to them about their F6 goals and how they need to do this stuff every day. And you got to be diligent. And you can see it in their face. They're like, "Whoa, what?"
Yeah.
And I can't quite understand what it is that it freaks them out.
There's a doctor we used to work with in Dallas. We got this guy to the top of Google. His phone's ringing all the time. If you set an appointment, Steve, for 3 o'clock with your doctor, you said, "I need to see my doctor for a checkup at 3 p.m.
Right.
In your mind, I mean, no one's perfect, but what's a reasonable, when should he meet you? If he said the appointment's at 3, what's a reasonable cutoff time? Maybe he's running behind. What's a reasonable time?
3. I mean, that's my pet peeve about these doctors. You know, they have an appointment for 3, but they don't see you till 3:30.
This is the thing
something.
Is his assistant knows that he's not consistent. So she says, I can't make it in today. I don't feel good. So he says, okay, you know, I'll give you the day off. So long story short, I'm not kidding. Clients were writing bad reviews going, hey, it's 3:30 and no one's greeted me. I called the guy. I said, dude, how come you haven't seen your patients yet? How come no one's greeting your patients? And he says, oh, I had to let her off the day because she didn't feel good. And it's like consistent, though. And if you look at his business, he never opens on time. He never greeted patients on time. And the bad Google reviews would not stop. I mean, he just on a very fundamental level struggles to be on time. If you struggle with diligence, I want you to listen to this wonderful Bible verse, and I'm going to switch to the voice of God one more time just so we get it, because you're arguing with God. You're not arguing with me. God says in Proverbs 10:4 that lazy hands make for poverty, but diligent hands bring wealth. It's a rule. It's a consequence. It's a cause and effect. You
and
know?
It makes sense.
It makes sense.
That's the weird thing about it. I don't know.
But I bet you this is the problem for 85% of the business owners I've worked with over the years. So I'm going to read the Bible verse to you in a nice sing-songy kind of way. Here we go.
Lazy hands make for poverty, but diligent hands bring wealth. Proverbs 10:4.
Oh, man. All right.
God can't help but do that laugh, can he? He just
no, that's the voice.
I was looking up around. I was there like, oh. But you know what? Even if God came down into some people's bedroom and said that every day.
Wake yourself up, you knucklehead. Unbelievable. You got to open up your medical clinic on time, you freaking idiot. This is not God. This is his brother, Naaman, who calls people freaking idiots.
Exactly.
God sent me, though. He told me to come.
God has a brother named Naaman.
They still wouldn't get up. They still wouldn't get up.
No, that's the thing. Here's the thing. If I told you.
This is the voice of God. You can have success, but you have to wake up at 5 a.m. every day. People would not do it because the voice of God and the 5 a.m. guarantee is still not enough motivation.
Right? People wouldn't do it. They wouldn't do it. They seriously, and that's what you hit. To be successful, you have to get up at 5 a.m. every single day and get stuff done. You've got to work on your business for at least 2 to 3 hours every single day. And if you're not going to do that, you have to stay up after the kids go to bed, Chuck. You have to do it.
That's important. Get up and work on your business. Don't get up and mull around with a coffee and watch the news for an hour and a half, and then all of a sudden you're, I got to jump in the shower and go, because then you're still late.
Yeah, and if you don't believe this, then just stop right now, because the next point about being coachable is for you.
I tell you what,
coachable.
Steve, when we come back, we're going to talk about coachability, my friend. I'm sorry to cut you off. We have some bills to pay, Steve. We have to pay the bills. We've got a little commercial break. When we come back, we're talking about coachability, and I am super excited to break this down with you on the Thrive Time Show on your radio. I'm a
sure you never miss a broadcast by signing up for the Thrive Time Show podcast. 2 men, 13 multi-million dollar businesses, 8 kids, 1 business coach radio show. It's the Thrive Time Business Coach Radio Show.
Lenny Kravitz, make it happen. Lenny Kravitz, wow. I cannot wait for tomorrow's show. Tomorrow's show, we're talking about the success and the path to success of Lenny Kravitz. How did he do it? I'm excited. Tomorrow's entire show is focused on how Lenny Kravitz achieved success. But today we're talking about how you can achieve success, and specifically the 5 steps you need to take up the staircase to success. Step number 1 is you've got to be diligent. Now, step number 2, you've got to be coachable. You've got to be willing to take advice from somebody who knows the proven path. In fact, Eric Schmidt, this is the CEO of Google, he said the number 1 advice he has for you is, he says, you need to hire a business coach. He says, my advice to you is to have a coach. He explains this. He says, here he is. He's the CEO of Google, and his number 1 advice is to have a coach. Did you know that Eric Schmidt's business coach, his name was Bill Campbell. Look that up. Bill Campbell. And Bill Campbell was also the business coach of the late, great Steve Jobs and the business coach of Jeff Bezos. So the guy who started Apple, the guy who started Amazon, the guy who's running Google, all had a business coach. And you know that I have yet to meet somebody who's in tremendous physical shape who doesn't have an accountability partner, workout partner, a coach. I've never seen it. And you know why that is? It's because the pull of drifting is simply too much.
Powerful.
It's too easy to drift. And by default, we all drift. All of us, every single person listening to the show, myself included, by default, if we don't have accountability or a coach or mentorship or a partner or something, we all drift. And people hate accountability, but they need it. And successful people love accountability. Successful people love that accountability. So
let me show you what I got done. That's the successful person.
Steve, I want to get your mind. I want to get your feedback on this and your mindset on having a coach. And then Eric, I want to get your feedback on this because this is, if you want to get in great physical shape, you need a coach. You need a personal trainer. If you want to get your business in great shape, you need a business coach. If you want to be successful with your accounting, you need an accountant to help you. Steve, talk to me about the power of having a business coach or having a mentor in your life, and maybe share some stories about some of the mentors you've had in your life.
Yeah, I think it's hugely important. In fact, I don't know if hugely is a word, but it's important for sure. So
hugely.
Hugely. The office
you
that
can
I
use the word hugely. That's just in the voice of God.
Oh, you're good to go, Steve.
Thank you, Lord. So the office that I'm in now, I actually am in and started in that office because I wanted to be closer to my coach, who was at the time Dr. Steve Green. And before I had any full-time employees, before I had anybody that I paid a coach, and I actually paid a coach more money than I paid after I did get employees than my first probably two employees, because I saw the value in it. And so what I did is I met with Dr. Green. And I actually had to drive to ORU, and I would go to the deli. You've been to the deli at ORU, right?
I have. Oh, it's a beautiful deli.
You can smell the bacon from like all the way down the hall right when you walk in the door.
It's bacon!
So I'd meet every Tuesday and Thursday from 7 to 8:30. Every Tuesday and Thursday. So it was two times a week that we were meeting. And that was in 2008, 2009. And so I think it's vital to your business that you have a coach. And Clay, you know this. Chup, you know this. When you're running a business, even if you have employees, I think the natural, what most people do is they have that like a person or two that's within their company that they trust, or that is like their kind of like right hand woman or man or whatever. But you don't really have anybody above that's giving you advice on what you should do with your business, on where you should go.
Let me give you an example from Proverbs 24. Proverbs 24. He says, the sluggard does not plow after the autumn, so he begs during the harvest and has nothing. So somebody had to point out, hey, listen, you need to plow after autumn if you're going to have a good harvest. You have to do that. And a lot of times in business, you don't know what to do. You don't know, you know, what should I be plowing? A lot of times it's not obvious what to do. So as an example, Chup, if someone's listening to this show today and they wanted to get to the top of Google searches, because a lot of people don't know what to do. Could you walk them through the four steps basically of what, and you know, and they're kind of broad, but can you walk us through what you need to do to be top in Google?
Yeah, so first you've got to build a website that is canonically compliant.
Okay.
Canonicals.
Canonicals.
Some people might say, well, what does that
what
mean?
Does that
well,
mean?
A business coach. A business coach would walk you through, and there's 37 specific points
right.
for that.
You got to be mobile compliant. You got to have a mobile compliant website that looks good on cell phones and mobile
do
devices.
Do people get on the web on their cell phones?
Not very many yet, but it's a trend. It's moving that way.
Are you guys using smartphones?
Smartphones.
Okay, so you get mobile compliant.
Mobile compliant.
Yep.
You've got to Google reviews. You got to have more Google reviews than everybody.
More Ooh. Reviews. Okay.
Of the Google type.
Do people read reviews?
Just a couple.
How do you get reviews? Again, your business coach would teach you.
Right. And then the last one is you've got to have more original content on your website than your competition.
And so a lot of people don't even know, though, what to do.
Well, that's the thing. You don't know what you don't know, right?
I didn't know that until I hired Clay and his team.
That's right.
I mean, I knew that like being top in Google was a thing, you know, that you could be.
It's like the new Yellow Pages.
Yeah, but I didn't know how to get there.
Right.
But I'm a smart guy, right? And I've done some things.
Another example, we have a lot of listeners, a lot of people we've worked with who want to write a book.
Mm-hmm.
And we can typically help you write a book, start to finish, get the whole thing done in like 3 months. Where there's actually a firm in Tulsa right now that charges $28,000 to write a book with you. And that book will take about a year. And we can get it done for about $6,000. And it would take you about 3 months.
Just a little bit better.
That's just
if you did that, Clay, would you have to write, or would you guys just do it for
you?
Me?
Would have to actually write the book in order to get the book.
That's weird.
What about ghostwriting a book? What if I don't know how to write?
Oh, nice.
Steve,
yeah,
it's okay. Sarcastic.
It's okay
because you can't be diligent and write a book.
So step number one, you got to be diligent. Step number two, though, you've got to be coachable. You got to find out what to do. And if you just on a very fundamental level, if you want to get to the top of Google, you have to find someone who's done it and ask them how to do it. Now, the next step is one that I'm very, very, very passionate about. And it's one that nobody else cares about. It's one that almost everybody else says, this is stupid. I don't want to throw anybody under the bus. They say it all the time. I don't want to throw anybody under the bus.
Yeah.
It's called loyalty. And loyalty means that you establish the bus, you get on the bus, and the bus goes from destination to destination, and whoever's in the way of the bus gets run over. The wheels on the bus go round and round.
You honk after.
The slackers in the way of the bus get run over all day long. So the thing is, the loyalty is about, hey, this is the bus, this is where we're going. And people that are getting out of the bus and protesting about the bus and
sabotaging the bus
and trying to yell at the bus driver, then what happens is that you have to run over the bus.
They get in fights on the bus.
Loyalty is standing up for something, even though it's not convenient. We come back, we're going to break down what loyalty means in the world of business. My name's Clay Clark. I'm a business coach. You owe it to yourself to subscribe to the podcast at ThriveTimeShow.com.
Do it.
Feel my heart. You make me feel like I'm alive again.
Live, local, and now, broadcasting from the center of the universe and the Thrive15.com world headquarters, it's the Thrive Time Show.
Sorry, we're going streaking through the quad and into the gymnasium. Come on, everybody! Come on, Snoop! Snoop-a-loop!
All right, Thrive Nation, welcome back to the conversation. It is the Thrive Time Show on the radio. And today we're teaching you specifically the 5 steps up the stairway of success. And this third step is loyalty. Now, when we talk about loyalty, I want to break down loyalty into 2 separate areas here. Area number one is you have to be loyal to your idea. You have to be loyal to your vision, loyal to your dream, loyal to your vision. You have to be loyal to your own vision. And very few people want to help you with that vision. In fact, I would argue that nobody wants to help you with that vision because it's your vision.
Even worse, people want to tear that vision down once you start getting some success, right?
Absolutely. This is what happens is that in business, everybody's going to run into some opposition. And so I run into that all the time with every business I've ever done. And so I'll give an example. DJ Connection. This just happened at the Elephant in the Room on Friday. This is on Friday. It's a men's only grooming lounge. You know, that's what it is. It's men's only. And we have a lady who's a lesbian who looks like a dude who wants to get her hair cut. And last time I checked, it doesn't say Elephant in the Room, Men's and Lesbians Grooming Lounge. It just says Men's Grooming Lounge. And I don't give a crap about political correctness. I don't care about making all the employees happy. I don't care. It's a men's only. That's the rules I've set up. And until I change the rules, I don't care. So I'm loyal to the vision. Well, that requires now the front desk person was like, sorry, ma'am, we just can't cut your hair. What do you mean you can't cut my hair? I have a man's haircut. So the person's like, well, you just can't do it. So the person decides to just get up on Facebook. It's a lot of fun right now. I'm sure you can find the comments on Facebook right now. It's a fun festival of comments. You can go on to our
Festival of Delights.
You can go on the Elephant in the Room Men's Grooming Lounge on our Facebook page. I'm sure you can see that. But the thing is, she's going to go tell everybody else that, oh my gosh, they denied me service because I'm a lesbian. I don't care if you're a lesbian or not. You're just not a man. And so I'm not going to provide you service. So I'm not going to. I don't have to. I didn't start the business to serve you. Well, I'm going to go tell all the lesbians. Okay, fine. Tell all the lesbians. Then I'll be a whole bunch of lesbians that I won't be cutting their hair either. Well, I'm going to tell my friends who sympathize with their cause. Do that. I don't care. The business does not exist to serve you. And I don't give two craps about your opinion of the world until government says I have to provide service for lesbians at my men's grooming lounge. I'm not going to do it. And if the government says I have to, then I'll have to. But that's just it's how it is. Also, as a father, you can't come over to my house unless I like your parents. Period. Yes. I don't care who you are. I'm not letting you come to my house unless I like your parents. I don't. You judge kids? I do. I will not. I will not let you in my house unless I like your parents. It's a strategic move because I don't blame the kids. I blame their parents. And I don't have time to run around righting all the wrongs of the planet and fixing our school system. All I can say is if your parents are idiots, you can't come over to my house. It's just period. I don't care. Another example. If I think you're a slow walking, chronically yawning, negative person, you can't come work for me.
Well, that's true, by the way.
Well, I just like to walk slow, and I like to yawn. I'm tired. Well, you can't come work for us because the wheels on my vision bus go round and round, and people who are in the way get run over because you're on the ground. So, the vision. You've got to be loyal to your own vision. Now, Chubb, this is the part I want to get your take on.
All right.
Jack Welch, the number one CEO of all time, who grew GE by 4,000%, he points out that you could talk all day about vision, but at the end of the day, if you're not willing to fire the jerks, it doesn't matter. So here's his notable quotable, and I want to have you break it down.
Right.
He says, CEOs can talk and blab each day about culture, but the employees all know who the jerks are. They could name the jerks for you. It's just cultural. People just don't want to do it. Jack Welch. Chuck, break it down.
I don't want to throw anybody under the bus.
Well,
you got to think about it like this. If you're a manager, if you're a business owner, and somebody on your team isn't loyal to the vision, to the process, to the team, then they're not really on your team.
I just want to save the files differently. I like to save
But that's them. Not how we do it.
I like to do it my way.
You're not on the team.
I don't No, seriously, on a fundamental level, people do that crap.
Yes,
they
all
say,
the time.
I don't want to save it on Dropbox. I just want to use You remember those freaking orange drives?
Yes, everywhere. They were everywhere, always.
Do you remember how I wanted to kill her? Remember that?
I just saw a look of fury in your eyes just right when you brought
up. Were you in the building when I got rid of the server?
Yes.
When I started losing my crap about the server?
Yes.
Can you explain what happened with the server?
There's a lot of things that happen with the server. I don't know where things are saved. I don't know where it's at. I'm putting weird things on the work server, and we all came to work one day, and Clay was just like, hey, guess what? We're not using a server ever again because it's not working out.
Right, and the thing was, we have Dropbox. It's all backed up. Everything goes to Dropbox. It's all saved, but people kept saving it on their local drive until they'll come back later and put it on the server.
And then they aren't around, or they're not there, or whatever, and the person that has to do the job next can't find it because they're not following the system.
Thus, I got rid of the server. And people were like, you got rid of the server? I sold it to Dr. Z for one of his businesses, and it's fine. We sold it to another company. Yeah. It's all as well. But at the end of the day, it's the undermining, passive-aggressive, culturally defiant crap. Steve, talk to me about that, because we're talking about loyalty. But you know what I'm saying? There's people who are just, they're cultural defiers. They're people that just, it's the passive-aggressive, I'm not going to record my call. Yeah. I'm not going to follow the script. I'm not going to save on the server. You know, I'm just not going to show up on time. Steve.
I know that you made a video, which is very, very good, on explaining how to download my calls and save them to Dropbox. But I can't figure out how. It's that person.
It's not that I don't want to.
Yeah.
I just can't figure out how.
I'm trying. I know a monkey could do this, but I'm trying. And yeah, you know, people, when they don't want to do something, they will find every excuse in the world not to, which is why with our outbound salespeople that make calls and follow a script, if I print out 4,000 leads that they need to call and I just say call these every day for the next 10 days, or I have them log in to the internet to do that, right? If I have them do that, guess what happens? Then they log in the internet and they're like, oh, my password doesn't work.
My password, I couldn't get on there, you know, overall. Basically,
they don't want to. So any opportunity that someone has to not follow the system or not be loyal, they're going to.
So here's an example for you. In my office, we have people that make cold calls all the time for the different businesses, and we make cold calls on behalf of our business coaching clients. One of our business coaching clients struggled to get their teammates to make cold calls. And it's hilarious, but I've had multiple occasions where some of our clients have fired employees for not doing a good job, quote unquote, and they come work for us and they do a fine job.
Whoa.
So what's the difference? It's because in my office, I will say, you need to make 100 calls today. And they'll say, oh, I need to get some coffee first. I'm like, no, you need to make 100 calls today. We're going to make 100 calls today. Well, I don't know what script to use, and I don't feel good. That's not how it works at the Clay Clark Show. You will make calls, or you don't work here. And it's a clear line in the sand, get on the freaking phone, make the calls, or get out of here culture.
Expectations, right?
Expectations.
You set them.
And so if you are listening to the show today and you are struggling with getting your employees to get things done, you've got a problem with loyalty is what it is. And you need some help pulling the weeds out of your business garden, because those weeds eventually are going to choke off your vision. You have got to fix the loyalty issue in your building. How do you do it? There's three. Three ways. One, you set up the expectations from day one. This is what you do. Step two, you tie compensation with the expectations.
Yes.
That's how you do it, right? You tie it so it's you're held accountable. You say you get paid not based on the hours you work, but on the results you produce.
Preach.
Like Quick Trip, like Starbucks, like UPS, like companies that are not terrible. You have to have a merit-based pay system. And the third, you must communicate how you are going to be communicated with. It's the expectations, it's the compensation and communication. You have to say, this is how and when you're going to communicate. Do not tell me that you couldn't make the calls because you couldn't figure out how to do it. You're going to go ahead and make the calls, and at the end of the day, there's a set time that you can ask me any questions. There's a set time where you can ask me any questions about the system, but you have to do the work. You can't not do the work and then get to the end of the day and say, oh, I didn't do the work. I was waiting to hear back from you.
Yeah, well, it's a big problem, too, and I call it, it's out of the book, The Ultimate Sales Machine, but the Gotta Minutes.
The Gotta Minutes.
Gotta Minutes will kill you, and I deal with this in my company right now. And I just have to keep coaching back to the system. Oh, I have a question. I don't care if you have a question. It's not time for questions. If right now there is a problem where you cannot complete your job, there's an internet problem, there's a phone problem, there's an issue, then by all means, come tell me if the building's on fire.
When we come back, Steve, I want you to talk more about Gotta Minute meetings. I want you to break down Gotta Minute meetings. And also, Eric Chupp, I want you to talk more about passive aggressives. Because that is really the issue, in my opinion, my experience with working with business owners, I've seen that the lack of loyalty in the company and the refusal to hold people accountable is really a huge issue. It's like three quarters of the problem. It's not knowing what to do. It's refusing to do it. And every time that they choose not to do something, it becomes more and more the norm. And then pretty soon you have a culture where people come to work and don't work. My name is Clay Clark. I'm a business coach. If you have yet to subscribe to the podcast, you really should do it. You got to go to thrivetimeshow.com and subscribe to the podcast. Also, if you've yet to be out to attend one of our in-person workshops, I would invite you to go to thrivetimeshow.com and book your tickets